Today we are here to worship the resurrection of Christ. And also to thank Him for giving us an ideal life of a saint who has to work for the benevolence of the whole world. We talk of Christ, we sing of Sri Ganesha, we say we believe in Him, especially Sahaja Yogis feel He is the eldest brother that they have, and a tremendous surrender I find among Western Sahaja Yogis especially for Christ. Because they were born in Christian religion, perhaps maybe, or maybe, that they found Christ's life a very special one. But to Sahaja Yoga, he has to be much more than that. And to you Sahaja Yogis, many people believe in many deities. Like some believe in Sri Krishna, some in Sri Rama, some in Buddha, some in Mahavira, and some in Christ. All over the world, they do believe in some higher being. But this belief is without the connection to begin with, and becomes a kind of a falsehood that they think that Christ belongs to them, Rama belongs to them, or Sri Krishna belongs to them. That they are the possessors of all these deities because they have obliged of believing into. And that is how most of the faiths have come. And though they ardently believe in Christ, all these faiths have failed. Because when they believed in Christ, they believed that through Christ they can get their checks cashed. It was like a bank. We pray to God, you get me all right, then get my mother all right, my father all right, my sister all right. Get me so much money, get me so much wealth or health or anything. Thinking that because we believe in Christ, He is so obliged that He has to pay for it. He has to look after us. And that we are rightful possessors of His blessings. Then they form churches, temples, mosques, clubs, believing that now we belong to Christ. All this group is a special chosen one, or we belong to Rama or to Krishna or to someone like that. And to whomsoever they may belong, the one to the whom they belong does not know anything about them. Christ has said, you'll be calling me Christ, Christ, I won't recognize you. It's a big warning to people who say we believe in Christ. So without the connection, if you believe in someone, it has no meaning. It's just like some sort of a mythical romantic idea that another person whom you believe in has a special relationship with you. So this assurance that I believe into something, or this assumption that I believe into something, because I believe into something, I have every right to get all the blessings that I ask for, is a myth, as you must have realized after Sahajyoga. But when you become a Sahajyogi, then you have got your connection with all of them and with Christ. But this connection, again, in a subtle way, is the same style. For example, what we try to do is to ask again that this should be done, that should be done. My agya is caught up, Mother, please clear it out. Or, I've got headache, so please put it right. Because you believe in Sahajyoga, you expect Sahajyoga to feel obliged. That see now, they believe in me, but it's such a great obligation. So Sahajyoga must do something for you. Whether you do anything for Sahajyoga is not important. Only because you believe in Sahajyoga. Because Sahajyoga has given you realization, so Sahajyoga has every obligation that it should look after. I am in Sahajyoga, still why should I suffer? I am in Sahajyoga, why should my mother not be all right? I am in Sahajyoga, as if sort of a organization where you have paid money or something and you are supposed to get all the rewards. But now let us see, after Sahajyoga, what should be our attitude, which is saying. The first is that now I am a Sahajyogi and now I am connected to Christ. So, what is my responsibility? Christ felt responsible for the whole world. He's described in the Devi Purana as the support of the whole universe. As soon as you are connected with Christ, the whole attitude has to change. So, to be connected with Christ means, what are the qualities of Christ you have imbibed within yourself? That's the minimum of minimum. What did you get out of his life? Is it that he has cured people, all right, so you should get cured? He gave eyes to people, so you must get your eyes back. Do you mind removing this? Or is it that his life, which you have enshrined, should also make you something that could be enshrined, that could be respected, that could be called as a reflection of Christ's life? Now let us see his life, what kind of a life he led. We read Bible, we carry Bible everywhere, and even I saw the Bible in the hotel as if it's a part of the thing, like a soap is kept in Bible. (Laughter) Of course, I read it. I don't know how many read it. But then it doesn't become to say you are a Sahajogi if through his connection you have not received any one of his qualities. For example, this is now connected to the mains, so you are getting electricity through it. This doesn't give electricity to the mains, but it receives. So you have to receive something from him. And what you have to receive is the qualities that he had. You might say, because Mother, he was divine. He was the Son of God. But he was also son of his mother. And you are also son of your mother. So mediocrity in our character cannot say that we are connected with Christ, because there is no energy of Christ flowing in you. When the energy of Christ flows through you, you express it. Like yesterday, the gentleman was playing, and I think the power of Saraswati started flowing in him. And how beautifully he played. He couldn't control his fingers. He said, it's all happening here, I don't know how. So throughout, if you see his life, he was a person who was all the time bothered about the benevolence of the world. How clearly he went and talked to the priests and told them that you don't understand me because you are blind. He told them that he knows his father and his father knows him, but you do not know me nor you know your father. So openly, blatantly, he was talking. He was not afraid that he will go to jail. He was not afraid that by saying such a thing, the ego of others will be challenged. Because he was not pretentious. He was not doing something that was not truthful. He was telling the truth, and truth has that capacity to express itself through your personality. But do we really believe in ourselves? Do we really believe that we are Sahajogis? That we can talk to people as Christ could talk to them? At a very young age of 12 years, he could go and talk to the priests. What courage! There was no need for him. He should have really got married, like Sahajogis do, and settled down with his wife and children nicely. Because the main headache for Sahajogis seems to be the marriage and their children. He never married. He was so precious that he didn't want to waste his time with these things. He died so young, he knew he had to die. So, in his life, you see, he was not a mundane type of personality, not mundane, not ordinary. I mean, he spoke with such confidence, with such knowledge of truth, that people did believe him, had to believe. They couldn't help it. This power you too have, and you can do the same. But the way he used his power Why can't we use? Because we are not intense about it. Our attention is on something else, which is quite frivolous, which is useless. All right, we are sadhugis. So what do we think? First thing we'll think, now today is a puja, what should I wear? Then I haven't yet pressed my clothes, or my sari is not all right. I have to match it, and how to dress up. All these frivolous things first come to our house, our brain. Or in the morning when you get up in your ashrams or anywhere, what do you think? If it was Christ, he would say, I'm sleeping still, I have to meditate, I have to be one with the Divine. He would not say, no, no, the Divine will look after, it's all right. The Divine will meditate for me. Yeah. After all, Parama Chaitanya, it has to meditate. Why should we meditate? We are all sadhugis. Everything is such. So let the Divine meditate for us. We can't get up in the morning. It's difficult. We can't. You see, just can't. But then you can't be a sadhugi. You are supposed to be connected with all the deities, not only Christ. And here you can't even get out of your bed to meditate, while all the deities are already up there waiting for you to get up, that's all. But they can't understand what's happening to these sadhugis. How can they be so low? After all, mother must have given them realization, thinking them to be something great. How did they get realization? They are so ordinary, so mundane, so useless. The deities start wondering, why mother gave them realization? Because a person who cannot enjoy his meditation cannot be a sadhugi. That's the first sign of a sadhugi, that he looks forward to that time when he can meditate. That is the time you are really in connection with the Divine and you enjoy the most. Whenever I get a chance, I go into it. I find it so difficult to come out of it. I mean, for today, it happened to me. First thinking that I'll have to struggle out for this puja. I'll have to work it out. I don't know how will I get out of this meditative mood. But it surprises so many people. It's brought something to put me to. How people are meditating, especially so many Indians told me this thing, it's something very surprising, that they are supposed to be meditating and immediately they get up, what cakes, what things, what have you cooked, this, that. There's no slumber of meditation in them. They just start thinking about food. How can that be? It's the way you cannot get out of your sleep. In the same way, a sadhugi cannot get out of his meditative mood. It's so enjoyable. You want to be there. So one of the signs that you are not yet anywhere near sadhuga is that if you cannot enjoy your meditation. I mean, imagine if you enjoy a television show or anything, you have to see it, isn't it? You cannot just say, all right, I'm sleeping now and I'm enjoying the television. So you have to be awakened to it. But that awakening is within. And there you see your own connection. It's a joy that I cannot describe really. There's only one word for that is Niranandam. It's just Niram, is only the joy, absolute joy. And who would like to give up the joy for what? For a cake or for a tea or this? I mean, just think of it. The joy is so deep, so intense, so beautiful. I don't know what else to say. You have not tasted the ambrosia. There was said as if the ambrosia is trickling down on your tongue. It's like that, the taste of it. But what I find, that the depth we have not touched, which is within us. All of you have that depth. That not, that you don't have. I have not given you realization because you are just there, here, because you have that depth within you. You are special people with that depth. But you haven't touched it. It shows you haven't touched it. Supposing it's like a well full of water, but you are still dangling somewhere in the middle. You haven't yet touched that depth. Because once you get into that, you get completely drenched and lost. But if that is not the situation, that shows that you are still somewhere dangling in between, and any time you can come high and dry. So you have to judge yourself. This is the time for you to judge. You are in connection with Christ. He achieved His resurrection, by which we have to achieve our resurrection. But what have we done to achieve that resurrection which He has achieved? He intensely lived a life of complete sacrifice and complete concentration towards one goal, that He has to achieve the resurrection. Nothing else was important to Him. All that attention was on one thing, that I have to achieve this resurrection, I have to get crucified, and I have to be resurrected because the whole world has to be resurrected. But Sahayogis, I don't know how many think that way. How many think that dedication is needed? And the best part of it, that is so joy-giving. Every step you move forward is so joy-giving. The sinking in that well is so very joy-giving. It's not painful. Don't have to crucify yourself. Don't have to carry the cross. He's done it for you. So what do you sacrifice? Is your laziness. When it comes to the satisfaction of ego, people are overactive. They are like bullets then. And when it is the satisfaction of their physical comfort, they become, I don't know. We had one Rakshasa called Kumbhakarna. He used to sleep for 6 months and used to be awake 6 months. But here I see people sleep for 12 months. What do you call them? Then they say, Mother, we can't keep awake. Why? Because you are not meditating. You are not one with Christ. Then his agya he controls. With that agya, you cannot sleep. If his blessings are there on the agya, you cannot sleep. You won't believe, with the slightest light, artificial light especially, I can't sleep. Because still Christ is awake. And I have to be awake. So you have to be awakened to this fact that we are Sahajogis. We have a special responsibility as our connection with Christ is. Our main responsibility is all the time intensely to think what we can do for the betterment of human beings. And what are we doing about it? First I used to say, count your blessings, because that was the best way to make people understand that there are blessings in surgery. Now I would say, count your deeds. What have you done for Sahaja Yoga? Sahaja Yoga has done so much for you. To say that Param Chaitanya will look after is absolutely absurd. If Param Chaitanya could do everything, why should it create human beings? One Adam and Eve were sufficient. You have to do it. Unless and until you become deep, it cannot trigger, it is helpless. It's only through you it is going to work out. Now, if there is no instrument, electricity cannot work, can it? Now, you should say the electricity itself must come before me and must do everything. You have to have the instrument, and you are the instrument, and if you do not want to do it, how can Param Chaitanya do it? It will be something like saying, as I told you, that let electricity do the job, it will not have any instrument. Can I work it out? Can you work it out? So, Parama Chaitanya has its own style. It can only work if few people want to work it out. It's an energy, and you are the instrument. But the instrument is more busy with the job, with the family, I don't know, all kinds of nonsensical things. Now supposing this instrument, which is meant for my lecture, forgets what it is and acts like a ladle in the kitchen because it's fond of food, say, for example. Then what's the use of making this useless instrument? It doesn't do what it has to do. It doesn't know what it has been made for. It has no purpose at all. It's such a useless stuff. So I feel there's a kind of a lethargy, kind of a very subtle lethargy working out. Like this, that we've done our job, let the young people do it now. You are matured, and the matured have to do the job. We have done our level best. What have you done so far? So much to be done still. And somehow or other, I don't know, we have to touch that area where such people remain, like the yesterday's player. He is not doing God's work. He's an artist. And he's working so hard to achieve perfection. He will get the same amount whether he is perfect or not. But he's practicing at all. He's listening to it. He's trying to develop it. All the time working it out so that his performance should be excellent. So he's seeking an excellence. Mediocrity has no place in Sahaja Yoga. Only through excellence you'll enjoy. Only through excellence you will really become Sahaja Yogi. Otherwise, you could be a headache to me and to yourself. You would be a headache to Sahaja Yogis. Most non-progressive destructive element, I would say, a person is who is not alert. You have to be aware. Aware of your responsibilities. So far, I have been saying that still the preparation is on. They have to correct themselves. They have to clear out themselves. They have to work it out. Still, their conditionings, this ego. But now, 20 years have passed. And beware. Be aware that 21st year is going to be a very big jump. I'm warning you again and again and again and again. And you have to work very hard to develop yourself vertically in balance with your horizontal growth. It's not my lecture for entertainment or anything, but should go to your heart, to your brain, to your being. This is very important. And you are not going to waste it. All the time you have to think that you are a Sahaja Yogi. And you have to know what you have to do in Sahaja Yoga. And how to achieve it. You should not be satisfied unless and until you have achieved that excellence. That's the very important, crucial point today. I wanted to tell you, because today is Easter Day, which was a very crucial point for the development or the growth of the spirit. Because Sastrara we could never have achieved if Agya was blocked. Christ could have said, all right, let Paramachaitanya do it. Let Paramachaitanya get itself hanged. Why should I do it? He had to do it, and he was the instrument, and he's done it. So Sahaja Yoga is not only for exploiters. If you try just to exploit Sahaja Yoga, you'll be exploited too. But it is for the exploitation of joy. But that's only possible if you grow, you touch your depth. If you are not deep enough, You will hang in the air, as I said. And that has to be worked out. That has to be found out. How best you can do it? How much you can reach people? How many people you can give realization? How many people you are going to help improve their health, their mental conditions, and then how much you are going to talk about Sadhu. So that is going to work out. What I call the collective assent of human beings. May God bless you. To be in connection with Christ is to be enjoying your meditation. All right. So puja is another thing which is, I know it helps you a lot. It gives you a definite push, I should say. But you don't retain it. You don't retain it. Then what's the use? So also you have to retain. Should have power to retain. That's only possible if you have touched your depths, which you have. I'm so happy to come back to you all. I missed you all very much. I'm traveling and working very hard. I don't know if I work hard. I don't think about it, never. So once you know that this is what you have to be, then you don't work, it just works. Then you don't think you are working. This is a subtle point you have to understand. That everything works out and you work in a way and it works out, but you don't work. Like the sun shines. If you ask the sun, poor sun, you have to work so hard. He said, when? When was that? She say, you have to rise in the morning, then you have... No, 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 no. I was just with myself, nothing else. I was with myself, I was enjoying myself. When did I work? As long as you are with yourself, there's no question of you getting bored, or no question of you getting tired, nothing. You are with yourself, finished. But unless and until that happens within you, then these problems do come up. And so, please, please, again I would say, value your self-realization. Value your realization. Value your life. You all are very precious people, and you are the ones who are chosen. I hope all of you come to Sastra Day after very intensive meditative time. Otherwise, Sunday I'll find people who are doing Sastra Puja with their all Sastras caught up.